attending. If you can identify, are you Sheldon?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Thomas. Okay, thank you. So just to let you know, we have 15 minutes set aside for you, and understand there's three speakers.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so each will have five or whatever, not to exceed 15.
Understood.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Worship. Shall I begin?
Yes, you may.
Okay. Good evening, Your Worship and members of council. My name is Sheldon Thomas. I'm a retired manager of water distribution for the city of Hamilton. Thank you for allowing me this opportunity to speak to you and your residents tonight. I'm going to tell you something about the chemical that you're going to have to live with if you decide to endorse fluoridation. The chemical you'll choose is a class of silica fluoride. You'll probably choose hydrofluosilicic acid or fluosilicic acid for short. These are not carefully designed chemicals. In fact, their very composition is so uncontrollable that no two chemical batches are ever the same. You should know going in that you are being asked to wrap your arms around a chemical that has never been proven for safe use in human consumption. We are closing in on 7 decades of fluoridation now, and not a single legitimate toxicology study has been located to prove that fluoridating chemicals are safe for use in drinking water. That lack of proof should have been enough to end fluoridation a long time ago. I'm going to provide you with a short list of surprises that await you if you bring this chemical into your homes. Expect lead corrosion in your water system like you've never seen before. Fluosilicic acid will combine with your chlorine disinfectant to create a powerful lead solvent. That dissolved lead will basically pour from your taps every day. Lead damages just about every organ of the body and can cause irreversible neurological damage among the very young. Expect fluoride to reinvent itself in your distribution system. The fluoride ion that you turn loose is a highly reactive element. It has to bond with something. For example, if there's any trace aluminum in your distribution system, and there is, fluoride will find it, bind with it, and create a new chemical called aluminum fluoride complex. The fluoride compound is neurotoxic. It has been shown to produce Alzheimer's-like symptoms in animal studies. Fluoride is an established enzyme poison and a hormone disruptor. It's known to target the thyroid gland, interfering with the production of essential hormones that control your normal metabolism. Be prepared for an increase in hypothyroidism in Orillia. Yeah, after just a few short years of fluoridation, this has happened elsewhere. San Francisco recorded a 400% increase in hypothyroidism within 4 years of the start of its water fluoridation program. There is an epidemic of hypothyroidism in North America today, centered primarily on fluoridated communities and affecting mainly women. You're going to be getting more than fluosilicic acid in that tanker when it rolls into your treatment plants. That liquid is going to contain a number of trace contaminants. Arsenic and lead are going to be there. Mercury can be there and often is. Barium, beryllium, cadmium, chromium, and 4 kinds of radionuclides can be there too. A handful of these contaminants are known carcinogens. These trace contaminants matter. Heavy dilution in drinking water doesn't make them insignificant. The arsenic contaminant alone is enough to cause one cancer in 10,000. 3 Orillia residents will suffer an avoidable cancer. Supporters of fluoridation will tell you that your chemical will be safe because it has NSF certification. NSF is National Sanitation Foundation, the private non-government agency. In hard fact, NSF's own laboratories will not be testing and certifying Orillia shipments for fluosilicic acid. NSF certifies only the chemical plants that make the acid, not the individual shipments that come from those plants. You are going to have to prove that the tanker contains what you purchased and that the acid complies with NSF chemical guidelines. Your water plant personnel are going to have to climb onto those tankers and extract at least 5 half-liter samples. Then they're going to have to do full-spectrum analysis of the samples following the guidelines of AWWA Standard 703, Section 5. Orillia staff is going to have to correctly test for and measure the concentration of 15 possible contaminants, including radioactive constituents. They will have to do it with every shipment. Your plant personnel are going to have to closely handle this highly corrosive toxin for the rest of their laboratory lives. And you are going to have to train them. You're going to have to make sure they're equipped and that they can do this safely. In summary, councilors and Mr. Mayor, I'd like you to weigh the legal risks of dispensing a chemical that has never been proven safe for use in your drinking water. Is it a prudent decision to impose upon your residents a chemical whose common constituents are known to cause cancer? Is the city of Orillia willing to inherit the legal responsibility, the handling risk, and the costs to prove for itself that every shipment of flosilicic acid is NSF compliant? All of this and more awaits you if you go down this path. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Mr. Sheldon. Next is it Heather?
Thank you. Good evening, Your Worship and Council. My name is Heather Gingerich, and I'm the author of the Fluoride Chapter in North America in this 2010 United Nations publication that was written expressly for decision makers like yourself in non-scientific language. I highly recommend that you read the 8 pages that are devoted to fluoride in water, but I'm going to spend the next few minutes sharing the new information that has surfaced in the last couple of years, for which your dental and public health officials did not cover when they spoke to you. The first risk you have to manage when adding fluorosilicate to municipal water supply is ignoring exactly what's in each shipment in terms of contaminants, as Sheldon mentioned. And this can only be accomplished with implant testing that the municipality will have to also pay for. The contaminants listed here do their damage by accumulating slowly in the body over time. And it is well established that aquatic species and unborn or newborn children in critical stages of development are more sensitive. So drinking water standards that are currently set to protect the average 2-year-old weighing an average of 28 pounds do not protect them or small pets. No proof or evidence of the fabled 100% dissociation of the fluoridation chemicals in real treated water has ever been produced. The contaminants listed on the last slide do not disappear, and in any case, there have never been any toxicology studies performed for any of the chemicals that you get from adding fluorosilicates to real treated municipal water. So there's no evidence of safety at all. Only about 1% of treated municipal water gets consumed, so the rest of the fluoride gets directly discharged into the wastewater stream. By adding fluoride to the level recommended by your public health unit, you would be exceeding the Canadian water quality guidelines for the protection of aquatic life by 5 times. Plus, you'd increase the leaching and discharge of heavy metals from the residential and municipal infrastructure into Lake Simcoe. Not only would fluoridation of Orillia's water supply be in violation of at least 4 pieces of environmental legislation, including the Lake Simcoe Protection Act, but it would make it impossible to monitor and regulate industrial fluoride polluters. At 0.7 milligrams per liter, Orillia would be over the adequate intake of fluoride for infants by 55 times without even adding any infant formula powder. When I asked Health Canada why they don't set the drinking water standards to protect formula-fed infants, their response was, and I quote, "Because infants represent too small a proportion of the general population," end quote. And they clearly don't care too much about the environment either. I've plotted the estimates from page 95 of the Health Canada Review and added the upper dosage limit according to the Canadian Dental Association. As you can see, mixing fluoridated water with powdered milk and soy-based formulas overdoses babies, and this does not even take into account the additional fluoride dose from toothpaste and absorption from bathwater. You'd also have to explain to a judge and parents of fluoride-poisoned children in your community why you ignored these clear warnings of actual experts in infant nutrition, of which your dental and medical officers and even the chief medical officer for Province of Ontario are not. The biggest risk of water fluoridation is the inability to control the dose, because that depends on body weight and individual exposures from all sources, not just the concentration in the water. Total fluoride exposure from all sources has gone up tremendously since artificial fluoridation was first introduced, and this as has the incidence of chronic disease. This is not a coincidence. This is Walkerton in slow motion. These are not health risks that you need to take. Because the Simcoe Muskoka District Health Unit offers several excellent dental programs for low-income families that can deliver professionally applied fluoride treatments in a truly targeted and controlled way. In terms of protecting the aquatic environment of Lake Simcoe and formula-fed infants, Orillia's water supply is already in the happy zone for fluoride. Why mess with it? It's not worth the risk. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas? I'm sorry, Mr. Fleming.
Thank you, Your Worship, members of Orillia Council. I appreciate the 5 minutes to speak this evening. Orillia contemplates hydrofluorosilicic acid fluoridation. As you know, hydrofluorosilicic acid contains fluorosilicates plus other trace co-contaminants. Health Canada and the U.S. Centers for Disease Control concede swallowing fluoride in drinking water has very little effect on reducing dental caries. Health Canada's Chief Dental Officer of Health admits a lifetime of swallowing fluoridated water results in less than one cavity reduction per person, also corroborated by Statistics Canada research. For decades, Health Canada and others said fluoridation is natural, like calcium fluoride in groundwater, while remaining silent on the industrial waste product actually being used these many decades to fluoridate. Health Canada has finally been forced to admit it does not conduct toxicology studies on fluorosilicates. Health Canada has also been forced to admit human health harm toxicology research has never been conducted on hydrofluorosilicic acid. Health Canada further admits hydrofluorosilicic acid is not regulated under Canada's Food and Drug Act, nor is it regulated under Canada's Natural Health Products Regulations. The United States Centers for Disease Control says while it promotes fluoridation policy, it does not determine safe levels of fluoride in drinking water. Ontario Safe Drinking Water Act subscribes to NSF Standard 60 for fluoridation chemical certification. Remarkable, when NSF Standard 60 does nothing to determine whether hydrofluorosilicic acid is safe or effective for human consumption. Moreover, National Sanitation Foundation has stated it shall not incur obligations, liability, damages, or otherwise pertaining to the use, interpretation, or reliance upon Standard 60. Ontario's Safe Drinking Water Act exists to ensure drinking water remains safe and without health hazards. Section 19, coming into effect January 1st, 2013, raises the standard of care, extending it to municipal councils. Council members are to be accountable and liable for what they permit into the drinking water system. Ontario Safe Drinking Water Act Section 20, Subsection 1 indicates nothing is allowed into the drinking water system if it could cause or result in a drinking water health hazard. Section 20, Subsection 2B is often used to defend water fluoridation as a statutory authority, then quickly pointing to the Ontario Fluoridation Act. Section 20, Subsection 3 points out that dilution is no defense when adding something into the drinking water which could result in a drinking water health hazard. Section 166 resolves how conflict between acts must be handled, whereby the Ontario Safe Drinking Water Act prevails over other acts unless the other act expressly states it prevails. The Ontario Fluoridation Act does not expressly state it prevails over the Safe Drinking Water Act. Therefore, Ontario Safe Drinking Water Act prevails and overrides the Fluoridation Act. Ontario's Fluoridation Act only pertains to a fluoridation system, equipment, materials, and compound for releasing fluoride ions into the drinking water. It remains silent on what chemical compound a municipality could or should consider. Ontario's Fluoridation Act also remains silent on why we release fluoride ions into a drinking water system. In 1957, the Supreme Court of Canada ruled fluoridating municipal drinking water to be a compulsory preventative medication of the inhabitants, and further ruled that the current statutory provisions would need to be changed to confer this intention before Ontario councils could pass bylaws to fluoridate. Ontario's Fluoridation Act has forever remained silent on why we release fluoride ions into the drinking water supply. Decidedly, the intent is compulsory preventative medication of the inhabitants. Ontario's Safe Drinking Water Act is about treating drinking water. It is not about treating the inhabitants of the community. And subsequent to this 1957 Supreme Court of Canada ruling, we have never subjected fluoridation chemicals to drug testing, drug trials, or drug approvals.
Presently, municipal councils still hold ultimate and final authority on whether or not to fluoridate. In that regard, council is all that protects Orillia citizens and all that protects itself. While much about municipal water fluoridation and fluoridation chemicals remains unlegislated and unregulated, councils and municipalities' responsibilities remain clearly legislated and tightly regulated. I'm sympathetic as to the position this places Orillia Council in, and I'm prepared to field any questions you might have, and I appreciate your time once more. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Funny. You guys right down to the minute. That's very good. Good timing.